You're listening to EdTech Heroes, a podcast that looks at how teachers in today's classrooms can use technology to improve student learning. In each episode, a hero in the world of education will share their story and discuss how innovation can influence the minds of the next generation. Let's jump in.
Hey, y'all, and welcome to EdTech Heroes. I'm Neff, and today's guest is Michelle Hearn. Michelle started her career as a seventh grade social studies teacher in 2014 and now serves as technology instructional coach in Middletown City School District in New York. In her current position, Michelle works directly with teachers and students to teach them how to effectively use instructional technology in the classroom. Michelle, welcome to EdTech Heroes.
I am so excited to be here. Thank you for having me.
Oh, absolutely. So I am really excited to talk about your trajectory as an educator. You started off as a teacher, and now you're teaching the teachers. What drew you to your role as an instructional technology coach?
Well, I was a young teacher and just starting to learn about blended learning. Our district had an initiative where they gave seventh graders Chromebooks. So the seventh graders had one-to-one devices. They brought them home with them. So I jumped on board and started being trained by Ed Elements. We were working with them at the time, and they provided us training on how to implement a flipped classroom model. I used Screencastify from the very beginning. I mean, this is back in like 2014 at this point. So I think your company was still relatively new at that time. So I used Screencastify to create all of my mini lessons, and the kids could access them at their own time. And this really freed up me in class to be able to work with small groups of students. So I was able to close gaps and have enrichment opportunities for some students. And apparently I caught the attention of certain people because when the job was posted, the assistant superintendent pulled me out of my room and asked me to apply. So I did. Whoa. And then the rest is history.
That is a crazy story. I feel like as a teacher, whenever you get a knock on your door, you're like, okay, what could this be? Right.
Yeah.
And then it's like, knock, knock, knock. It's the assistant superintendent asking you to apply for this position, which is incredible.
Yes, it was. I'll never forget that day in my career. I was like, my heart was pounding. I was like, oh my God, what happened? I like called my husband. He was my boyfriend at the time, like right away. And I was like, you're never going to believe what just happened to me. But it was really, really exciting. And it also felt very fulfilling because I feel like in life, I'm very type A and I work so hard, and I would be up in lesson planning, especially recreating every single lesson that I had already created through using Screencastify. And I used choice boards and playlists. I mean, I spent hours after school and I would literally work until like 10, 11 o'clock at night. So getting that knock on my door was like a pat on the back. I was like, wow, like my hard work is recognized and it felt good. And I just continue to push myself in this role now. And I absolutely love it. I love working with the teachers. I miss the students, but I still am. I run a newspaper club. So that kind of like gives me a little bit of a student love as well.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. And I feel like that is the perfect thing for you to do as a civics teacher, to now run this newspaper. Yes to the freedom of the press, and also yes to some student connections, which is pretty dope. Yeah. So I'm curious to learn a little bit more about your current role. So you went straight from the classroom, got that knock on the door, and now you're helping lead teachers to do exactly what you are doing. How do you kind of use your classroom experience to be a really good coach?
It's literally everything. I use my classroom experience every single time that I work with a teacher. I'm constantly referring back to what I did in the classroom, sharing what I had created when I was a teacher, but also since then, things have been changed and modified and made so much better as well. So in working with all these different teachers, it allows me to see what they're doing and combine it with what I did, and we can create some really cool things. So teacher to teacher, it's always nice. Like when you're working with someone who has experienced what you're going through, you know, you get that connection. And I love it. I love collaborating with all different grade levels. And that's fun and different for me too, because if you were a social studies teacher, you know, you kind of like stick with your pack, or you might do a little bit of humanities and work with the English teacher a little bit. But now I work with all teachers, grades K through 12, all subjects. And it's really incredible to see what everyone's doing in their class and to kind of like take a little bit of everything and then compile it and then share it out. So that's probably one of my favorite things about this job, is working with others and learning from them, just like they're learning from me.
Yeah, I love that, because you're this awesome figure that is around helping people throughout the district, but you also get to take something from one school that maybe a 12th grade chemistry teacher told you and say, you know what? That might actually work in this kindergarten classroom. You strip it down from the content, but a lot of times these concepts or these principles of student engagement can be deployed across any subject, across any grade level, and you get to kind of be that conduit of collaboration and communication, which is so cool.
Yeah, it's really awesome. I really enjoy it.
And I'm going to brag on you for a little bit, because it's clear that your district is doing some amazing things. Y'all are a part of an elite group of the League of Innovative Schools, which sounds like it could be a superhero group. You are a national leader in education elements. So clearly something is going right. How have you all been able to achieve this consistent technological excellence?
It's all about our leadership, honestly. We've had really good leadership. Dr. Eastwood, who was a superintendent for years, really put this district on the map. And all of our technology initiatives is really what drives us. And our community is great and supports the school, and the teachers are on board. And just the way that we kind of went about training the teachers was great. We worked with Ed Elements, and I mean, they're a fantastic company, great group of people. We would pull out like groups of 10 teachers at a time and train them. They would get like a 3-day extensive training, and then they would go back into the classroom and, you know, for a couple of weeks, try out what they learned. And then we'd pop into their classes and check it out. And then we'd pull them out again for training. And it was just a really great time and experience for teachers to collaborate and share with each other and learn new things. And without this district supporting all these initiatives when it comes to technology, like, we would not be where we are today. The fact that in now after the pandemic, I mean, every single student has a Chromebook in this district, and we're a big district. We have 7 schools. So it's pretty incredible that we're able to do this for these kids. And I'm just happy to be a part of it. I bleed blue. I love it. Like, you know, I wore my midi blue today, and I never would have thought that growing up that I would be a midi, because I grew up in the neighboring town, Minisink, which is like a very farm town. Like, I grew up on a lot of land, and this is more like city-like, but I love it. This district is great.
That's awesome. I love that pride is just emanating from you right now. In terms of those initiatives, a lot of times we might talk to districts who have these like really, really big overarching principles and ideas. And the challenge then becomes getting those principles and ideas from the district level down to individual schools, down to individual teachers. How have you all been able to establish buy-in so that everybody is bleeding midi blue and cares a whole lot about these ideas?
Buy-in is difficult, but we've noticed that it spreads best organically. So we'll start the initiatives, and, you know, we'll say, this is what we're offering in training wise. We pull the teachers from their class. We offer after school professional development. The fact that we have so many TOSAs and coaches in this district is huge. There's 4 of my position. I'm tech TOSA. A TOSA stands for teacher on special assignment. So all of our instructional coaches are teachers and past practice, which, again, back to what we were saying, like, helps like mend that connection between each other. But like I said, like, it spreads best organically. So we have a new content provider. We will throw it out there to a couple teachers that we know would be interested. We have some after school PDs. The way that we teach the teachers will be using those providers. And then as soon as one teacher jumps on board and it starts working, then they tell their friends and then they're like, oh, that's interesting. And then I'll say, yeah, like sign up for me and I'll come during your prep and I'll show you about it. And that is the best way to get buy-in. And honestly, the pandemic actually helped a lot of those teachers who were reluctant about technology and recording their lessons using Screencastify and using choice boards and playlists, really had no other choice during the pandemic. So that kind of definitely put a fire under people's butts. So that mm-hmm. was a lot of work on our end, the Tectosa end, because we were getting inundated with so many people who needed our help. And I was working such long hours in the beginning of the pandemic, and I had a 6-month-old baby at home with me. So it was really tough, but I felt like I reached so many different people because being kind of backed into a corner and then having to use the technology. And then they like saw the light and they saw like, wow, like I don't have to stand in front of the classroom and talk to the kids until they're blue in the face. Like I can do my mini lesson and record it and then add in interactive questions like you guys have now, which is awesome. And then I can use that time during class to like work with the kids and make connections with the kids and pull those small groups and have enrichment opportunities for the kids that are ahead. And, you know, it just kind of shed a light on everything that technology can do for the teachers. And it was pretty awesome to watch.
Yeah, absolutely. It sounds like this approach is so multifaceted. One of the things that you said that I think is so cool is that folks who are in your role are using the technology tools that you would like to see teachers use with students. So teachers are able to come in and see what that makes possible from a learning perspective. So yeah. If I go to a professional development session and I watch a Screencastify video and I'm like, whoa, that was so much better than what we used to do, then immediately my mind starts to tick about what I might be able to do with students, which is really, really awesome. I want to talk a little bit about this teacher to teacher sharing, because it sounds like that is of utmost importance to get one teacher on board, understanding the benefits, and then have them just share with their friends, not necessarily because you've told them to, but because that's what teachers do. Do you guys find that there are teachers that are just prone to sharing, or are you incentivizing this in any way? How does that work out?
I think they're just prone to sharing at this point. I feel like, what's the phrase, like steal, borrow. It's losing my mind right now, but teachers just, they want to help each other for the most part. You will have those teachers who kind of keep all their stuff to themselves, but I've noticed that in past practice way more than I notice it now. In the last, I would say like 5 years, I can see teachers, they just don't care. They're like, yeah, I made this awesome lesson. Like you can use it and modify it. And all of our content providers, majority of them have really great sharing options where either there's a district library and you can just put everything on the district library and then you don't even have to have any type of communication with the teacher. You can just say like, oh, that's a cool video. I'm going to like grab that one. Or I really like this lesson that this teacher put in like the Nearpod library. So I think that makes sharing a lot easier, is that you're not like, don't even have to like go up to that specific teacher and say, hey, can I have this? We also have a really good mentor program in our district. So each new teacher is hooked up with a veteran teacher. And then we have clusters and department chairs and departments that really work very closely together. So, and also we want our kids to collaborate and share and create together. So teachers do the same thing and the kids are going to model what they see.
Yeah, absolutely. I love that on all accounts of having a mentor teacher. I had that my first year as a teacher and Miss Jean Pierre was amazing. And I still sucked because teaching is hard, but I definitely sucked a little bit less as a result of her mentorship, and really, really awesome to have that. So super cool, super cool. Yeah. One thing that I know that you've talked about in the past is this really big push toward more personalized learning throughout the district. Can you talk to me a little bit about why that's so important and how you all are actually achieving that?
I mean, personally, is learning is everything, in my opinion, because I don't even know like how I learned the way that I did in school. Like when I think back to like what I did as a student in school, it's so industrialized. Like it's like the factory model of education. It's like, okay, your students are grouped by age. They come into the class, they sit in rows. The teacher stands in front of the class. Like the students are expected to just be quiet and listen and take the tests. And, you know, it's just like really geared towards like producing like this like uniform product, which is very similar to a factory. And if you think about, you know, when the school system was created, like that's what we were preparing our students to do. They were leaving and they were going to a factory where they were going to go to their station and do their work quietly and wait for the lunch bell to ring and then go to lunch and then come back. And that was like their daily lives. But our students are not leaving the school to go work in a factory, more likely than not. I know obviously factories are still very important and like those jobs are much needed, but we're living in this innovative world and a majority of our students are going and they're going to work in tech companies and startup companies and they're going to be innovators and you have to collaborate with people. And, you know, I think it's our job as educators to motivate them and to excite our students to figure out what their passions are and then encourage them to find careers based on those passions. So that goes back to personalization. Personalized learning has really the power to transform the students to learn and create and innovate and figure out what it is that they need in order to be successful. So by personalizing every single student's learning, it allows them to grow. And technology aids to that. Teachers are like, well, how am I supposed to do that for every single kid? I have 120 kids. Like, how am I supposed to personalize every single kid's learning? And that's kind of where content providers and technology comes in by using Screencastify, for example, to record your mini lessons and gather that data by adding those interactive questions. Like now you're able to kind of look at that data and chunk the kids. Okay, who's struggling with what concept? And since you're not standing in the front of the room anymore, taking up all that time, and the kids are watching this at their own time, at their own pace, like you now have the ability to pull those groups of kids who need to, you know, a little extra help in this area. That's personalized learning. And having content providers that create these personalized pathways. And based on how the students are answering the questions, it's going to push out recommendations to them, you know, so like using the technology to your benefit is huge. And I mean, data, data, data. It's all about data. Like you have all this data and you have to analyze it. And I don't think teachers realized they were going to be analyzing as much data as they are now, but knowing how to successfully read the data from the content providers and all of your assessments really helps drive your instruction to personalization.
Yeah, absolutely. I love that. And I think that there are so many tidbits there in terms of being able to look at data, being able to think a little bit about how we personalize instruction based off of who we are talking to. And then also, I think recognizing the ultimate goal, right? It is probably not to teach a standard, although that is so, so, so important, but recognizing that we are preparing students to enter the world and we want to give them the soft and hard skills to be able to do that. And yeah. I think what's interesting about what you just posited is that it really is the opportunity to allow students to explore their learning and their working styles. Yeah. And when they get to a startup environment or a company where they're given all of this autonomy to be able to get the job done, how do they operate in that environment if all they've done is sit in rows and learn at the exact same pace of all of their peers? Like it becomes really, really hard to adapt to that.
Exactly. Exactly. And having that sense of ownership too. I mean, when you go and you talk about like student choice, like I think student choice is everything. That's why I kind of ended up like steering away from playlists. And for anyone listening, like a playlist in at least in our world is like the kids are going to do something in a chronological order. And you're like chunking information for them. You're giving them tasks and assigning them activities or watching videos or whatever it might be. And they have to do it in an order. And I kind of have been gearing more towards choice boards because having choice makes such a big difference in everybody's life. I mean, I relate it to my own personal life and like my two-year-old, sometimes doesn't want to go up to bed and take a bath. So if I say, come on, we're going up to bed, we have to take a bath, like it'll be an immediate no. But if I say, it's time to take a bath right now, would you like to hold my hand up the stairs or would you like to walk by yourself? It's like automatically like, it's time to take a bath, but now I have a choice. I can either hold mommy's hand or I can walk upstairs alone. And it's like, either way, she's coming upstairs. So, but just giving her that choice, like all of a sudden gives her like ownership. And having ownership is huge because ownership makes you feel that you're in control. And it kind of gives them this feeling of empowerment. And by students being able to choose the way that they want to learn, really lends to that personalized learning experience because it's in the end, it's their choice that they're making. So I'm a huge choice.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's also about investment, right? Like now maybe your two-year-old is excited to get to the bathtub because at least she got there the way that she wanted to.
Exactly.
Or our students are excited about learning about binomials because at least they are learning in a way that speaks to their learning style versus it being like, this is just the lesson. If like it or not, this is what it is, which is awesome. And we talked about that a little bit on the podcast and just anecdotally that engagement in lots of instances is a prerequisite to student learning. If they don't care about what we're talking about, it's pretty unlikely that they're going to be able to have good learning outcomes because you just aren't invested in that, right?
Right. You have to access that prior knowledge. It's like one thing that we tell all teachers to do, like APK, like whatever it is you're learning, you're teaching them that day, like access their prior knowledge. How does this connect to them in their real everyday life? Like how are they going to make that connection that they need to that topic in order to continue learning about it? So I completely agree with that.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. So you were on a recent panel with some EdTech experts and some folks that I work with here at Screencastify, and you talked a whole lot about empowering students and empowering teachers as creators. Can you talk about why that's so important? So not just giving students choice in how they learn, but also giving them the opportunity to be able to share their voice.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we're in an era of innovators. I think of my husband. My husband builds race cars for a living, dirt modified race cars, and he is constantly innovating and inventing and creating. And in the world that we live in today, there's constant new ideas, there's constant new products available, you know, and the kids are growing up and we're grooming them to go off into this world to be creators and create and innovate. So they're going to feed off of what they see. So if they see that a teacher is doing the same lesson that their brother did 5 years ago, and they're not doing anything different, then they're going to feed off that. But if they see that teachers are creating and trying new things, it's going to encourage the students to do the same thing. I also think that we need to show both teachers and students that failure is okay, because with failure comes resilience. And if you just have to keep trying, like, again, I think back to my husband, I can't tell you how many times he's changed his race car every day. It's like, okay, this didn't work, so we're going to change this. We're going to try something new. So if the first time you try something new, it's not going to be perfect. The first time somebody created anything, it wasn't like, oh, one time I created it and then now it's perfect and I never had to change it ever. So by trying again and teaching the kids, you're working on something, you're creating something, you're trying to learn something, you know, whatever it is, it's not going to be perfect. You're going to probably fail in a certain sense. You're going to need to make adjustments. So by empowering students to do that, by showing them that we're doing it too, I think is really helpful to them to know that it's okay to fail. It's okay to try again. And that's what creation is all about.
Sure thing, sure thing. And I think it's also in the way that we model that. A lot of times we have folks come over to Screencastify and they say, hey, the reason that I'm not creating videos is because I'm not Anne Hathaway. And I'm like, well, neither am I. But sometimes you go out and you just try it, right? Yeah. And there is so much to be gleaned from putting a not perfect product in front of our students so that they understand that they too are not expected to be perfect. They might stumble over their words. They might say something not exactly in the way that they want to, but with tools, they have the ability to be able to edit that just like they would have in the real world. They have the ability to try again, just like they might have in the workplace. And we're teaching all of those skills as educators, which is so important.
Yeah. And I think you saying that makes me think of like how I was way back when I first started flipping my class and making my videos. It was just, you know, me and my husband at the time, no kids, but we did have a dog. And I would be upstairs and I'd be making my videos and they would be like 6 minutes long. And then my husband would scream up like, babe, what's for dinner? Like my dog would come and like squeak the toy. And I'd be like, I have to recreate this entire video now. Like, but and I would do that in the beginning. I would be like, oh, all right, fine. I guess I have to start over. And I would start the whole thing over. But then after a while, I was like, you know what? I'm leaving it in there. And I'll never forget the first time I left, I think it was Babe, What's for Dinner? I left it in the video and I was like, I'm just so tired. It is what it is at this point. I can't tell you how many kids were like, what'd you make for dinner? Like, they were like, it like caught their attention. It like showed them that like, I'm a real person and I have a life. And like, I started leaving little like Easter eggs all over the place in my videos and the kids loved them and it started to become like kind of a thing. So I think that's okay too, to show them that, like you said, not everyone has to be perfect. This is not a script. It's not like a movie. I know now that was like before you guys had the editing tool. Like now I know that I could have just edited out that little spot. Now you have this like awesome editor, but yeah, that was like a fun thing to do, to leave in those little Easter eggs for the kids. They loved it.
For sure. For sure. And it's like this backdoor way to build these student teacher relationships. I don't have any kids, but I do have a dog who makes some appearances and some folks might have seen her in a PD session or in something of that nature. And it's an instant conversation starter to be able to say, you know what, I'm invested in this session because you at least have a cute dog. So I'm going to listen to what you have to say, which is great. All right. Before we wrap up our discussion, we have a segment here, which happens to be my favorite, where we ask every single one of our heroes to share some tips for teachers. So I'm going to ask you, how can teachers become better creators?
How can they become better creators? I would say be resilient. Because just like I said, like, I feel like a lot of teachers, I know teachers, actually, I'm working with one on Friday, who's like, I just can't get Screencastify. Like they're scared to create and to build something. And I say it to my daughter all the time, like you're strong, you're smart, and you're brave. And you just have to sometimes take those risks and know that it's okay to fail. And know that you have all the tools and the technology behind you to make it what you want it to be with that little bit of effort. Also, when you think about like creating with your kids, like getting to know your students is, I think, like my number one tip for people. Having that connection with your kids and knowing exactly what drives them, what their passions are, what their home life is about, what they're interested in creating, I think will have a huge, huge success when it comes to getting the kids to want to create, whether it be a Screencastify video or, you know, even a diorama. I haven't heard that word in such a long time. Whatever it is, just know that you can constantly go back and fix and change and perfect.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. So resiliency is key. Final question, what are your favorite online resources to share with teachers?
Obviously, Screencastify. I literally use Screencastify every single day. In my role, I teach with it. So I don't have to be right there next to them. They can send me an email, how do you do this? And I can easily help them by screencasting. Other favorite online resources, one that's been pulling on my heartstrings recently is Nearpod. We started using Nearpod during the beginning of the pandemic, and big shout out to them because the company is great. They have already pre-made lessons. They have a ton of interactive activities and collaborative activities that you can put right into your slides. And it just makes such a difference with the kids. Instead of that 10-minute, 15-minute mini lesson, just doing a video or you talking, it allows them to do like a time to climb or a pole or a drag and drop. So I would say Nearpod is probably also another go-to for me.
All right. I love it. So if you're listening, check out Nearpod. They have some dope activities. I've used it myself and I really, really love it. And I know we have some other Nearpod fans on the Screencastify squad. So thank you for putting us on to a really, really awesome tool. Michelle, I so appreciate you joining EdTech Heroes and sharing your expertise. I am your host, Neff Dukes, and I'm looking forward to the next episode.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Thank you for listening to this episode of EdTech Heroes, presented by Screencastify.